Hi, myself Naveen Kumar Saini. In the course Wireless and Mobile Communication, code REC085, today in the lecture 6, we will discuss the wireless channel and the radio communication. So, basically, what is wireless channel? As we know, from the transmitter to receiver, we have the medium that is wireless. Okay, so main property of the wireless, that is the unguided medium. Okay, if it is the wired channel, then it will be the guided medium, but in the case of wireless, it is unguided. So there are the different ways through which the wireless channel can be analyzed. The first one is the fundamentals of the electromagnetic wave theory. So in that, the parameters which we can go through, that is the phase velocity, phase propagation, construct the amplitude, its frequency and the phase. So, this phase propagation constant comprise the attenuation constant and the phase constant itself. So, all these parameters we can analyze through the electromagnetic waves theory. Second is the ray theory. So, in that, the refractive index dependency and the diffraction of the EM wave can be analyzed. And the third way of the wireless channel, which can be realized through the DSP, that is a digital signal processing, or such as in that we can discuss about the channel transfer functions, spectrum, channel inputs, impulse response, and the convolution and transmitting signals. So, these three are the basic ways through which we can analyze the wireless channel. Okay, so next is the radio waves. So basically, as we know about the EM theory, that electromagnetic field theory comprises the two components. First one is the electric field, second is the magnetic field. So the electric field and the magnetic field both are perpendicular to each other, and which is perpendicular to the direction of traveling of the wave. So all the components of electric field, magnetic field and the direction of the traveling of wave will be comprised, all these components will be perpendicular to each other. But as we know about the EM wave, it also propagate from transmitter to receiver through the different frequency levels. So, these frequency levels are comprised here. We can see that it is starting from very low frequency from here, whose range is 0.003 megahertz up to the approx 3 lakh megahertz. This is above than the extra high frequency EHF, right. Next, so the propagation of wave can be through the different polarization. So, these polarizations are based on your electric and magnetic components. So, here the electric component basically which is a wave result that propagate from the voltage changes. Okay, so that occur as the antenna excited by the alternating waveforms. Okay, so this electric field is measured in terms of the change in potential over a given distance. Okay, so for example, so it is the voltage parameter, and its voltage parameter. So this value V upon L is called the field strength. So, this polarization can be of your three types, linear, circular or the elliptical. So, if we talk about the linear polarization, so in that first thing which we must know, that the polarization of the EM wave which indicate the plane in which it is working. So, in the linear polarization, it is very simple one, where it includes the vertical and the horizontal polarization, and which are the straightforward forms, and the wave can be thought of as vibrating in a single one plane. Okay, so this single one plane, as I said, if we have something this type of plane, so E component, if this is the E component and this is the H component, so the propagation of the wave will be through this plane, on this plane. This is a uniform plane wave, and the propagation direction of wave propagation will be in this direction. So, this is the k, just for example, we are just mentioning about the wave polarization. If E and H component, these are in same plane, then we call it as the uniform plane wave. And the simplest way of polarization is the linear polarization. Next is the circular polarization. In the circular polarization, it is visualized by imaging a signal propagating from the rotating antenna. Okay, so the if E and H components are in observed from the transmitter side in the circular form or in rotational form, then we call it as a circular polarization. Next is the elliptical polarization. If it occurs, there is a combination of both the linear and the circular polarization. Okay, so next topic that is very important is the free space propagation model. So this is one of the standard propagation model through which we study about the properties of the wireless communication, where we signifies about the power density. Okay, so it is basically is a Friis model itself. We call it as the Friis model. So free space is a space that does not interfere with the normal radiation and propagates a propagation of radio waves. So it does not have any magnetic or gravitational forces or the fields, solid bodies or the ionized particles. It means in the free space there is no obstacle is there, right? So that is why we call as the free space. So this is a very standard form which is not possible to have around the our earth radius around the earth. So we have to just for standardization we study the free space propagation model. So the rest of the propagation models, when the wave is propagating through the different mediums, we can observe after that. So it gives the law of the mathematical relationship for the power versus distance. Okay, and the power radiated from the antenna propagates in space. So it is given by the Friis model or the free space propagation model. So in that Friis model, Friis space model basically is valid for the values of d. So that are in field of transmitting antenna and less than the radio region. So how it is defined by the radio region? So it is defined by the Fraunhofer region first. So we call the fall field as the Fraunhofer region. From the this name was given by the inventor, and it is based on the wavelength for the carrier wavelength lambda. The transmitter antenna aperture a t, then the Fraunhofer distance will be the df is equal to 2at square upon lambda. So this df, if the distance is below this length, so this is the df. If it is less than this value, d value is less than df, then it is your near field. If it is more than df, then it will be the far field region. Okay, and the before below df value is called the non-radiative itself. And above then, this is the Fraunhofer regions, okay, and it is a far field region also. Okay, so what is the flux density or the transmitted power? So we just for assumption we are using the half wave dipole antenna, where the flux density at a distance d is given by the F is equal to pt. So this is the formula for the flux density. F is equal to pt upon 4 pi d square. So d is the distance from the transmitting antenna to that point where we are observing the power. Okay, and this distance may be measured can be comprised between these two near field or the far field, and that value can be observed by the df. Okay, so now at this moment we are assuming the gain of the antenna is 1. So but if there is a gain of any antenna where this value is gt, then the power the flux will become F is equal to pt gt upon 4 pi d square watt per meter square. Okay, then the power p are received by a receiver with an antenna with the area that is ar. This is the area of the receiving antenna. Then the total power received will become flux density into area of the receiver antenna that receives the flux density. So this value is F into eta A R watts, where the eta is what? This is the aperture efficiency, and A E is the effective area of the receiving antenna. Okay, so this is the way through which we can calculate the receiving power at the receiver. Okay, then when we put these values, then after manipulating the equation, then P R received power will become P T G T A E upon 4 pi d square. This is watt per meter square. Okay, then the again we are assuming the receiving antenna gain, that is G R, is given by 4 pi a e upon lambda square. So from here we can use the value of a e and we can put it in the above equation, then the final value of received power will be getting p r is equal to lambda square upon 4 pi d whole square p t g t g r is a watt per meter square. Okay, then the wavelength we can calculate with the help of c by f c. So these all are the values through which we can find this equation, that is the received power at the receiver antenna. Okay, so PT is what? This is the transmitting power, and this antenna, transmitting antenna, has the gain PGT, and the receiving antenna has the gain GR. Then the PR will be the received power at the receiver side. So now come to the point where the path loss is also there. When there is a wireless channel, then the path loss will also be there. So this path loss can be calculated by the formula that is given by the, in the dB we are talking about. So the most of the time we power this value will calculate based on the dB. So this value is 10 log of PT upon PR. Okay. So in this PT upon PR, so this value we can calculate it from the previous example here about the lambda upon 4 pi lambda upon 4 pi d, right? So from here we can get it. Okay, so in this case the power loss value, when we take it from the previous slide, that value, then loss will become 10 log of 4 pi d upon pi square. Okay, so when you do some manipulation in that, so this value will be your minus 10 log lambda square upon 4 pi d whole square. Okay, so this is the final expression for finding the received power. So it will be P R up is equal to lambda square upon 4 pi d whole square into L. So this L is nothing but this is the path loss. So we can get it in the ratio form, or we can get it in terms of dB. Okay, so the, if L is the system loss factor and which is not related to the propagation, so it may be greater than or equal to 1. It means there is no loss. So there is some noise parameters which we have known before in our previous semester itself about the noise factor. So noise factor is what? This is the input SNR to output SNR value, and this value is given by the F noise is equal to GKT naught B plus delta N divided by GKT naught into B. So this expression we will use some most of times in the wireless communication system, where the noise factor is also be present. Noise figure. So this is a figure of merit basically. So this is nothing but the figure of merit, and noise figure is noise factor which is converted to the decimal. So in decimal value we can use that 10 log of that noise figure. Then the noise temperature, this formula it is given by the TE is equal to F noise minus 1 into T naught. So here TE is the anti log, we can take it. So from here we can solve this type of problems. So all these three parameters are used for the noise parameters: noise temperature, noise figure, figure merit, and all. Okay, so next model, that is the ground reflection loss calculation using the two-ray model. So this model comprises the basically three components are used for the ground reflections. So for that, the ground wave, which is of first one is the LOS wave, then ground reflected wave, then the surface wave, which is shown in the figure, okay, then the surface wave has a negligible amplitude itself. Then the two ray model is also used, which following this one. So this is the transmitting antenna height. So this is the receiving antenna height. So this transmitter send the request in two ways basically. First one, it is passing through this in the direct wave. Second is a reflected wave which is passing through that. Okay. So then the length of this length can be found by taking the mirror image of the transmitting antenna and extending the line to its from the point of reflection. So in this way we can get this way, right? If we want this length, so for getting this length we will take the projection in the mirror image in the bottom of the surface. So okay, so this length will be same as the this length. So this is the way through which we can solve the different type of numericals. Okay, so in that the transmitting antenna HT, receiving antenna HR, and the path length of the line of sight wave, that is D, and the reflection component, that is R. So in that way the E component we can, or the received electric field strength in complex form, we can get it through this equation, that is E is equal to E naught, and this is 1 plus RC e to the power j del plus 1 minus RC s e to the power j del. So this RC is what? This is a ground reflection coefficient. E naught is the field strength for propagation free space, and the del is the phase difference between the direct and reflected wave, and the s, that is the surface attenuation, and its value will be less than 1. We assume there is no surface attenuation, so that is why this value we are taking very less, that is less than 1. So the horizontally polarized wave can be observed by this formula, that is RC of sine phi and all this. So when we will put the these all values, then we can get the value of RC from this. Okay, so these all are the some parameters which we use for the horizontal polarization or the vertical polarization. So these formulas we can use for getting value of RC. It depends if this polarization is horizontal or the vertical polarization. So based on that we will use the permittivity, relative permittivity of the medium or the surface. Okay, so based on that we can find the value of RC. Then the del is a path difference. With this formula we can get that, and del in that is the 2 HT HR upon D. Okay, so these all are the different formulas which we can get it the value of PR, which is the received power, and this complete received power PR will become lambda square upon 4 pi D whole square and 2 sin 2 pi upon lambda HT HR divided by D whole square PT DT GR. So the value of D, we can use the 4 by lambda HT HR. So length of the antenna is also we have to design based on the wavelength. Okay, so the beyond the turnover point, so basically we can say this D value is standard, and it D becomes the turnover point, that is DT. Okay, so beyond this turnover point, as per the Elick's model, so this value will become PR will be your HT HR whole squared by divided by D square 4 PT GT GR. And from the range D value of D, if it is between 1 to 50 kilometer, then the received power will be given by this formula. Okay, and the frequency range is 30 megahertz to 1 gigahertz. Then next is the diffraction loss. So if the loss, the line of sight component is obstructed by the single of NIF edge type, then an obstacle is with the height of HM, then the diffraction parameter V can be calculated based on this formula, that is V is equal to HM and in bracket, that is under root of 2 by lambda 1 upon DT plus 1 upon DR. Okay, so based on this we can calculate the value of V, this is the diffraction parameter, and then we can diffraction loss can also be approximated as the this one. If V is less than 0, then this P diffraction will be 0. And if V is 0 to 2.4, so this value will become this. This is standard experimental values, and P diffraction B will be 13 plus 20 log V if V is greater than 2.4. So now the total loss in the wireless communication can be observed by the formula, that is the total path loss will be given by the P total in dB we are talking about. So this will be in free space power loss plus the grounded power loss in dB and the diffraction power loss in the dB. So this is the total power loss in the wireless system. Okay, so now come to the fading part. So basically fading is what in the LAN mobile system. So fading is nothing but this is the attenuation in the attenuation amplitude of the electric field or the electromagnetic field theory in the electromagnetic field. Okay, so this fading will occur when there is a transmitter to receiver and this signal is transmitting from different paths. Okay, so maybe some direct path from transmitter to receiver, or maybe some reflected path from the different medium. So the fading will occur. So basically if we are transmitting this signal and after diffraction of multiple copies of the same signal is receiving at the receiver with a distorted form. So this distorted form is called the fading basically. So there are two types of fadings are there. First one is the large scale fading and the small scale fading. So large scale fading is it is for the radio propagation over the long distance. Okay, and the small scale fading, so this is due to the time varying reflections from the surroundings near the receiving antenna. So this small scale fading very very much effective in the wireless communication section. Okay, so we cannot avoid the small scale fading in very large extent, but a small scale fading can be little bit, we can manage it, but we cannot manage the small scale fading itself. So this is complete classification of the fading channel. So as I have discussed, the fading channel effects can be of two types, that is the large scale fading and the small scale fading. The large scale fading, it comprises two parts, mean signal attenuation versus distance and the variation about the mean. Similarly, we have the small scale fading of two types in the time domain. So time spreading of the signal and the time variation of the signal. So similarly, in the frequency domain, we use the Fourier transform pair for converting it. So different this fading concept can be understood based on the time domain in the or in the frequency domain itself. So based on that, we define the frequency selective fading, flat fading, then frequency selective fading and flat fading in the case of large scale fading. In the case of again the small scale fading, we have the fast fading and slow fading in the time domain, and the fast fading and slow fading also in the frequency domain. In the both the domain, we can define the these different type of fadings. But the how to represent this all mathematical form, we will discuss it now. So the large scale fading basically is of two types, in logarithmic scale and in the free space path loss also converges in that. So average attenuation which is exponential proportional to the distance is the one type, plus the shadowing. So shadowing or the diffraction, this is the second type, and the secondary wavelets wrap around the large objects. If there is the large objects between the transmitter and the receiver, so in that case the diffraction will takes place or the shadowing concept will be there. Then because of that, the large scale fading will be come into existence. Okay. Then the small scale fading, what are the reasons behind the small scale fading? So for that, first reason is the random frequency modulation due to the varying Doppler shift on the different multiple signals. Second reason is time dispersion, that is the echoes, and which caused by the multi-path propagation delays due to the nearby objects. And the third reason behind the small scale fading is the movement of surrounding objects. So these three are the Doppler shift, multipath, or the movement of the objects in the surroundings creates the small scale fading. So in that we can also understand two few parameters about that, like delay spread, which affects mainly to the small scale fading, and it causes the ISI inter-symbol interference, or we call it as a bit crashing or simmering into the one another. like direct signal, if this is a signal which we are transmitting, and then it will be reflected and delayed by some obstacles within the medium like this, then the received signal will, it will be what, this will be the distorted or the ISI will be present here. Okay, so this is the effect due to the multipath itself, because when it is transmitting from the transmitter and it is receiving at the receiver, then it will follow different paths, right? Different paths like line of sight or non line of sight. So this this type of paths will create the when it add at the receiver, then this will create the fading concept will be present, or the distorted signal will be received at the receiver, and we call it as the ISI, inter symbol interference. Okay, next is the maximum delay time spread. So this is what, this is the total time interval during which reflections with significant energy arrive. Root mean square delay spread, so it is also a standard deviation or value of the delay of reflections weighted proportion that energy in the reflected wave. So this is the parameter, right? So what is the way through which we can reduce the inter-symbol interference? So for that we have the different methods like OFDM, orthogonal frequency division multiplexing, which reduces the ISI, and then we have the, we can remove the interference between the symbols using by using the filter, that is Nyquist 0 ISI criteria, right? And third one is we can manage the ISI by controlling the transmission rate in the general. Also these three are the ways through which we can remove the ISI. So the coherence bandwidth, this is one of the main factor in the wireless communication through which we can define that which type of fading concept is there, small scale or large scale, or what are the, as we have discussed the criteria or the definitions of the different fading, we can judge based on the coherence bandwidth. So for a reliable communication without using adaptive equalization or any anti multipath technique, the transmitted data rate may be much smaller or inverse of the RMS delay spread than called the coherence bandwidth. Okay, so the transfer function which remains the virtually constant over the coherence bandwidth. So this is a complete scenario about the coherence bandwidth. Next is small scale, small access time delay and the large access time delays. So all these things are the some parameters which is used in the wireless communication to define the different type of fading concepts. Okay, so as I discussed about the coherence bandwidth, so reciprocal of the coherence bandwidth is the maximum access delay, and based on that we can define the frequency selective fading or the flat fading concept. So basically what is that? So when the transmitted data which is much less than the coherence bandwidth, then the wireless channel is called the flat channel or the narrow band channel. On opposite of that, the channel will become the frequency selective or the wide band channel. So we can see this this here, that the wide band channel is given by this frequency selective fading, and the narrow band is the flat fading channel. Okay, so if the, as I said, the transmission rate of the signal is less than the coherence bandwidth, then the this type of band will be occur, and the transmission of the signal can be easily received or the obtained in the wireless communication system at the receiving side. Similarly, we have the Doppler effect, that is the correlation between the Doppler spread and the coherence time, as well as the definition of the slow and fast fading. Okay, so frequency selective or flat fading, we can discuss, we have discussed in the last slide based on the coherence bandwidth, and similarly we can define the coherence spread using the Doppler spread and the coherent time, we can define the slow fading and the fast fading. So this this criteria for exhibit the fast fading or the slow fading, it is given by here, right? If the symbol period is longer than the coherence time, then in that case it is the fast fading. If the symbol rate symbol time is period is less than the your coherence time, then it exhibit the slow fading. right? So in this diagram we can see in this effect we can define the Cohen's time and the Cohen's bandwidth here. Okay, so this Cohen's bandwidth will be in the axis of increased Doppler spread, and the T naught is the Cohen's time is increasing time spread. So in this section you can see if the TS is less than T naught, then it will be the flat fading, okay, a slow frequency flat fading, and BC, if the W is less than BC like this, then it will come into the first section, okay. So second is the fast frequency flat fading. So this will occur when the T naught is when the TS is, we can say, we can write it like this. If this is a TS, this is less than T naught, and if this is B wavelength W is greater than BC. So this is the case of the fast frequency flat fading. Okay, similarly we can discuss it about this one. If here we see the slow frequency and the flat fading, the condition for that is if TS is less than T naught and W, this is the wavelength of the signal, this is the bandwidth of the signal. If this one is less than BC, then it will come into this section. So this is called the slow frequency flat fading. Similarly, we can define this one. If this TS is greater than T naught and this is W is less than BC. Similarly, and the fourth one, if the TS is greater than T naught and W is greater than BC. If these criteria are there, then we can define different types of channels, okay. So last topic, this is the shadowing. So shadowing is nothing but this is the effect that causes the received signal power to fluctuate because of the objects or the obstacles occur between the transmitting and the receiving part. So these fluctuations which are experienced on the local mean power, and that is short term average of the fluctuations due to the multipath fading, okay. So in that the slow shadowing, it complicates practical cell planning to fulfill the predict low local shadow attenuation. We have to update all the time to the cell towers. So there is a, we have to provide some threshold value to that. So we see there is a threshold from there. We can see if this portion from here to here, if the signal power is above than this threshold, then it is a non-fed period. And if it is like this one, you can see if this power is less than the threshold, then it is a fading section, this one or this one. So these two are the and this one itself. So these are the fading section through which the shadowing will takes place, and this portion we called as a outage. So this is the technical term which is given to finding the error or the if it is beyond the threshold or if it is above the threshold, okay. So for that we have the parameters of for getting the signal outage and the fading margin. So for that you can see there is the RMS amplitude, there is a local mean fed margin F, and the threshold value. So this threshold, receiver threshold, is given by the cell tower structure. Also we have engineers can provide this threshold value so that we can calculate the outage or the shadowing portion in the and in that we have also provide the margin. So before and below that it cannot be, power cannot be detected, okay, and the above that one we will get the received power, that is perfect, okay. And in that the PDF of signal amplitude and the phase margin, it gives the outage probability, okay. So this outage probability, it basically depends upon the signal amplitude variation and the fed margin with respect to the receiver threshold level. So this is the complete scenario about the wireless communication which we have discussed about the different parameters, about the fading, about the noise, or about the Friis model through which we observe or analyze the wireless channel of the system. So it's all about from my side today's lecture. So in the different type of models we will discuss in the next upcoming lectures. Okay, thank you very much.